as they believe in the unity of CIS, Europe, and North America.
Listen, if DC wins this, I'll erect a shrine to Suns fan in my house or something.
I don't know, maybe.
I want you to do... I think we should get that in writing, and I think we should get you to put a horse's head on your head while you do a panel or something.
I heard you don't have a lot of furniture in your apartment.
I don't have like a mattress on the floor, two chairs, and a shrine to Suns fan. He's going to have dates over, and he's going to be like, I lost a bet, sorry.
You're just going to have to deal with it, man.
That's not good. Okay, what is good is that the draft is underway. There's nothing surprising. There is a bounty at Doom. And a Beastmaster. Do we see the Invoker ban from one of these two teams? It'll have to be DC if it is. Or maybe we see a pick. No, it's a Batrider. Okay, so we kind of talked about the Batrider being really popular for NewB right now. It's 95% win rate over the last 3 months. They picked it a ton of times.
Go back to the lifesteal right away.
Yeah. Back to the lifesteal.
Second highest win rate, right?
A second highest win rate on NewB right now, yeah.
I feel like Slaughter is one of the best solutions against Lifestealer. Hard stuns, the low cooldown on that, amp damage that can kill him even through rage. Because watching the two games last night, the EG and the Secret losses, Lifestealer just looked like a crazy tear in both of those games. I really feel like you need a good solution to Lifestealer. Otherwise, he becomes an OP hero. And when you have those solutions, he's mediocre.
To be fair, I think that in the EG and Secret games, the reason why Lifestealer looks so good against those teams specifically is because those teams are... To counter Lifestealer, you need a lot of teamwork. You need to be able to kite him as a group. And to be fair, like, those teams right now aren't exactly a team. They don't have a lot of teamwork. They don't have... If a Lifestealer pops out of a bomb, you know, a delivery system and just goes on a hero, I feel like those teams are more likely to panic or ditch that person that gets bombed, and then Lifestealer just runs over the rest of your team.
And so many times we have seen that you get a stun on Lifestealer, and then your teammate is too slow to follow up because you're not on the same page, and he just gets rage off, he turns around, and he just kills your team.
Exactly. It requires, you know, trust and communication to beat a Lifestealer.
That being said, I really like those two heroes against Lifestealer. Whether he's raged or not, they have an answer to him, and so far...
And they play a very good line, and they also steal it from NewB. So,
Yeah. I haven't played a huge amount of Void recently, but...
What about Void versus Lifestealer? That sounds pretty good, carry versus carry.
It is really good.
Time walk away, you can Chronosphere if you really want, you can bash him through Rage. It's like a lot of good solutions there.
It just becomes a bit scary if Lifestealer gets like a Puck or Quap that can actually disable the Void, so Nakes can just kill him. But we'll have to see how that goes.
They've decided to go with the IO. They've been prioritizing the Phoenix recently, but we've seen very, very low win rates so far at this tournament from the Phoenix, so that's no real big surprise.
We also don't see IO picked very often in this tournament, because he's also first banned.
Second highest ban rate.
Yeah, but I'm pretty sure NewB just picked it to counter the Faceless Void, because you chrono the Lifestealer, for example, you just relocate him out.
Right.
The chrono wasted.
10 seconds. Okay. DK Invoker banned, Sinnoh Invoker going to either team.
Not a big surprise to see the Invoker on the ban.
I sort of like Phoenix for DC here. It's not super good against Lifestealer, but you have a good chance of getting double Sunray with Io in the game. And I guess they do have attack speed amps though, so it's kind of bad versus Egg, but...
She was very standard meta so far though.
But I would really like the Phoenix pick though, because you would force the Lifestealer out of position for sure to hit the Egg, and then you can get a really good chrono off, and the Phoenix doesn't care about the chrono because you'll still be in the Egg.
Yeah. Maybe that's...
For DC?
Yeah, for DC. Yeah.
Maybe that's the issue with Phoenix, is everybody was grabbing it first round rather than doing a supplementary pick.
Yeah.
That happens a lot actually, when a support hero becomes powerful, all of a sudden teams say, oh, what's the best support hero? I need to pick a first phase, and then there's easy workarounds, and it leaves you weaknesses.
And that mostly goes for supports. Why carries that are popular still have a high win rate is simply because you have all the money, the counters that you have might not even be counters because you're just way too rich and you will just beat them.
Yeah, you can adjust with items, whereas supports can't really do that because they don't get the items as fast.
It has been a popular pick for DC. They do have a decent win rate with it as well. 11 games played, 10-1 in the last 3 months.
With Phoenix, right?
Yep.
And they go for the Darkseer ban. Makes sense. Could set up some really easy Lifestealer ganks pre-relocate, give some good lane pressure as well.
Especially if they plan on running the Faceless Void as a carry. Darkseer is one of the best heroes against that.
And they ban on AA, which is a great counter against Lifestealer, and IO as well.
And IO, yeah.
So if they do initiate, do chain stuns, ice blast, they could deal with him, but that option's gone. I still think Lion Void is a good solution, though.
Does suggest a little bit of lack of homework on Newbee's part, in the sense that DC have not played AA in the last 6 months.
But then again, Void AA has always been a very, very strong combo, especially on LAN events. It's one of the safest combos and one of the strongest combos to pull off when you just want to be safe.
Mm. Yeah. And what we don't know as well is they may have played that in some of the scrims.
Yeah. A lot of teams haven't been playing AA, but you've seen that resurgence lately, especially with Liquid picking it up a lot.
I don't even think it's a hero that takes much practice to get back into either. Like, the most difficult thing is landing Ice Blast and maybe short range and thinking about how you move around the map changes, since AA is more static, but any team can pick it up.
These kind of guys at this level, a couple of games on in practice is enough, isn't it?
I don't even think they need one. If they played it in the past.
I mean, it's very simple to run in a team as well. AA just needs level 6, your hard lane carry just leaves and goes and does something else, and then AA takes the lane to get level 6.
Especially here. You chrono, you AA blast, you can't miss that, it's impossible.
Yeah.
Like, even without practice. I'm really scared for Newbee right now. The DP Void is one of the strongest combos in the whole game. Would you like to see something like a Slaughter offlane, maybe?
Yeah, I think Slaughter for Newbee for sure. Like, it deals so well with DP. She's
and
got high
HP.
Now. And good against Weaver. And it's a stun, which follows up to help them kill Faceless Void. They're really lacking disables right now. I think that could work quite well. Disruptor is going to make it pretty scary for DC as well. Just anybody that gets out of position is going to get punished, so DC has to do everything correctly. And I fear for them doing slow pushes, like just slow 5v5 pushes, because Disruptor punishes that so much once you start retreating.
And I actually think IO Slaughter can be very good on the offlane. If they start, like they initiate on the Slaughter, and then IO comes in at the right time, they have no stuns left, and then they can just turn it around and get a return kill instead.
And it just makes Lifestealer's damage so much higher. Like, if Lifestealer goes on somebody that's amp damage, he turns from somebody that already does tons of damage, and then he just starts three-shotting your carries.
So here's the question, has KP played Slardar yet in the offlane?
That's a better question.
Because that's definitely, I'd be really surprised if anybody except for Hal played the Lifestealer. That guy is the original Lifestealer. He played that hero when it was good, when it was bad, everything.
It's true. I do kind of like Weaver this game, though. Very good versus Lifestealer.
Yeah.
Good to put bugs on IO and Disruptor. It's something they're going to have to deal with.
This is a different look. How do you feel about this? So that's probably going to be a move Viper in mid.
It's okay. Their damage is a bit weak on DC. It's very, very slow over time. So if they can keep them alive with IO, it's real strong.
Yeah, it's not a lot of burst to go through the Viper, but at the same time, it's very static. It's not a...
And they picked it in response to Weaver.
Yeah.
It's like, the only thing, like the only answer they have to Weaver right now is Disruptor. And as soon as Weaver gets a BKB, they have no answer to him anymore. He will just kill the IO easily. They can't do anything about it. And then they have Void to just keep the Lifestealer and Viper in place. If Viper doesn't snowball really early on, the hero becomes worthless, in my opinion.
I like his chances against a DP mid with an occasional Wisp coming in, though. Because if he gets Spirit Siphon and he has one Encrusive Skin, that's going to slow her by, what, 10% or whatever? Yeah. 10% plus his orb, plus two right clicks. I feel like it's something that can actually punish her, especially with Nether Toxin, because once she gets low, he's going to do more damage, which will offset what Spirit Siphon normally, where it normally keeps you alive. I actually kind of like it here. It will make them very immobile going into the mid game, but the laning stage, they could really snowball off of this.
The Viper for me has always been a very risky hero. Of course, on the lane, you will dominate most likely, but if you can't find the right transition with your team, getting tower pushes, then you don't have any way to catch up and farm. So for me, it has always been a risky pick. But of course, like, NewB ran it a lot, they know what they're doing. And they probably played against DP in the past too.
Yeah. I think NewB here really need a Lifestealer delivery system. They need a way to start fights and initiate, or else Viper can't do it. And the only catch that they have is Disruptor. So for right now, they absolutely have to get something like maybe a Slardar.
It got banned.
Slardar being banned.
Oh, that's hard for them.
What heroes does he have left? He usually plays Doom.
Batrider.
Batrider. I haven't seen Slardar, but they just banned it. Darkseer as well. There's not that many offlaners left.
They really needed to pick Slaughter, I think.
I think so too. I didn't like the Viper pick there. They wouldn't have banned it for sure.
It was a very small chance that they do.
Tide's
good, I guess. It's kind of similar, but
Then you're playing around Ravage and Digital Chaos. I guess they're also pretty ultimate dependent as well, but NewB is a team that likes to be aggressive. If your aggression is limited by the cooldown of your ultimate, I worry for how this affects their playstyle.
I really like DC's draft though. Void, he crones the Tidehunter, they can easily burst him down with a Crabulous ult. And you can't do... I mean, you can probably relocate him out, but it's gonna be so hard. You have to be in position all the time, and I don't know if they can pull it off. And still, Weaver gets a BKB. What answer do they have?
Titan
the
no
Ravage,
lockdowns.
Yeah, they have nothing.
Except for Basher on Lifesteal.
Yeah, or Abyssal later maybe, yeah, but and until you reach that point, they have nothing.
And their bombs, until they get Blink on Tidehunter, are non-existent.
Right.
Unless they just do relocate bombs. And even then, they still have to worry about Chronosphere, they have to worry about Earthspike, they have to worry about DP silence immediately afterwards. There's so many good solutions to what NewB has. They really needed an earlier Blink hero than Tide.
Look, I really don't want to make a Shrine to Sun's fan in my house.
Alright, one thing going for them is that Viper can get mech, and then Tide can go Blink first. So they've got that. They'll get the Blink faster than normal.
Okay, so the Chen is our final pick. Very quickly, Battle of the Drafts, Charlie.
Man, I really don't want to make a Shrine to Sun's fan in my house, but I do like DC's draft better.
Okay, Black.
I like DC better this game.
I like their draft better too.
Interesting. Our panelists are not split either way round. They have gone for DC in the draft, but all three of them have predicted that the series will go the way of NewB. Let's find out how it goes in game one with your commentary team, Toby One and Capitalist.
Well, it's not a surprise that the panel is split. Most people are saying NewB are by far the superior team, if not the number one team now that Team Liquid's been knocked down, while Digital Chaos, they're the team with a hope, and they're a team with a really good draft.
Yeah, they're a team that's actually been ramping up, I would say, as this tournament went on. I didn't have very high expectations of them, and even after the group stage, I thought their group was probably the weakest, but I had an opportunity to be able to talk to Weeha this morning. He feels really confident about this matchup, so we'll see what happens. They've got the draft to do it.
Yeah, and I can't wait to start it off, and we're going to do it right now. Let's go to the game.
Prepare for battle.
So here we are for game number one, NewB versus DC, a full best of three to see who will advance themselves forward and stay in that upper bracket. NewB, they are the favorites coming in, but will DC be able to topple the Giants?
Oh, look at this already. Some very early smoke warding action, as the mid lane is definitely going to be the point of contention between these two teams. You need to be able to establish a strong laning phase for both sides, particularly for NewB, as they do have the more tempo-based lineup. And both teams actually went for an early smoke and tried to get some vision down on the mid lane without the opposing team knowing.
Yeah. So battle for the vision. Of course, this is something which I kind of want to break it down a little bit before we start off in our fights, because it looks like the runes are going to go pretty much not normal trade. DC, the panel was leading towards them. They're saying, hey, this draft is looking really, really nice. The Chen pickup came at the end. They didn't have much time to talk about that one. I know you were very happy to see it come through. How is DC going to approach this game? Are they a push lineup? Do they wait it out? What is their play? What's their timing?
I believe the two ways to deal with NewB right now. Ooh, resolution. This is very dangerous play, but
NewB actually got both. They got both the bounties. Howl and Viper took them.
Well, either way, at least Digital Chaos don't give up a first blood, because they do have the draft advantage. I would say the two ways to be able to deal with NewB right now is to play hyper aggro and try and push them off their game, or to actually take away the late game. Because if you watch the way that NewB have drafted over this last period of 2 months, they usually try and give themselves the better late game, and when they're forced off of it, they usually are able to get themselves the better pushing style heroes, most notably Dragonite, time and time again appears in their lineups. But here, they don't get the same kind of pushing power from NewB, and DC will be able to stall out this game, I would say, a decent amount. I think they did draft themselves the superior position in game number one. The analysts really agree, and I think overall Digital Chaos just became very aware of what NewB's biggest strengths are and how to exploit them. I know they spent hours talking about this matchup yesterday, and it seems like at least in game one they do have something figured out.
Yeah, they got a lot to work with. At the same time, NewB are going to understand that they don't have everything which they normally have to work with. So you're seeing Karker and Mu trying to force Weeha further back in this lane where they can get aggressive. They're going to get aggressive, rely on just their superior regeneration to get an advantage. The Chen wants to influence it a little bit, but like, he's not like an Enchantress where he can just like take a Wild Wing, leave it in that mid lane, then use another creep to farm up. So the Chen's a little bit more restrictive for the moment.
Yeah, because of the fact that they had Viper up against Death Prophet with a Wisp as well, you know naturally that this matchup is going to go favorably for Newbee, so you needed to be able to pick up a 4 position that would have some sort of influence in the lane. And Lich, I think, was one of the heroes banned away by Newbee towards the end, so yeah, there wasn't much left. So trying to go into a jungler, I think, was the best option for Digital Chaos. The Chen can still have some impact in lane, as you could already see with his Hellbear Smasher trying to at least create a tiny bit of space for our Death Prophet.
Yeah, and I think which allows Weehan just to get a little bit of money into him and have a decent progression without having to like walk away from the lane too, making sure that Weehan gets that level progression in. But all the lanes are still fairly passive for now. Like on the bottom lane, it's just Mu versus Hao. There's not really a chance for either player to really find a kill here. Even once you get Chronosphere up, it's not going to be that good up against Hao. And Mu can always just like time walk himself out. So that lane's gonna be fairly passive. The middle lane's kind of like this bit of back and forth kind of tussle, but Newbee doesn't want to force too far because Spirit Siphon's an easy way where any kind of engagement can just be turned around. Not to mention, you don't know when the Enchantress are gonna come, or the Chen's gonna come in. And then you're gonna Tidehunter up on the top lane, the tankiest watermelon of them all. How do you kill him with a Weaver early on? The Weaver needs more time to get damage, and the Lion Harassment doesn't really do much against the Tide either.
One of the big things is I feel like the Tidehunter should actually have a lot more pressure against him than the Void, just because I think Void will match up pretty well against Lifestealer and Disruptor. But the difference is right now is that KP was able to get his ward down that blocks away the Hard Camp. This is really limiting the pull of Digital Chaos.
This mid lane, Kaka's actually in a lot of trouble. The prep was being worked so hard by Misery. That Satter was chasing him around for a good minute and a half and managed to hit a couple of those blasts, and then DC are able to capitalize on that little chip by chip by chip, and having no more bottle charges available for the IO, first blood goes the way of DC.
That is actually huge because this gets Weehaw into a pretty comfortable position for his mid lane. He was behind in CS, and my question was, how is a Death Prophet actually going to transition into the mid game with a bad laning phase? Well, even though he's low in CS, that first blood obviously makes his net worth look quite respectable now.
Yeah, that actually pushes him above the Viper as far as net worth goes, so they're looking a lot better for Weehaw. Of course, this is still a bit of a timing, and maybe this is something else we should think about here for DC. Speaking of timings, you have Exorcism, as well as a Chen. Can you slip in and take early Roshan's? Is this another way where DC can get that advantage against a more counter-initiating newbie lineup?
Potentially, if they can actually get themselves a relatively early Desolator, I think Deso BKB is going to be the item build for the Weaver in this game, just because the AoE disables. If they can get the Deso and find the right kind of pickoff with a Chronosphere, they can actually try and attempt to do an early Roshan. But Newbee are going to be more of the tempo controllers, and just naturally through map control may have the first Roshan in their hands. I anticipate them to be the ones taking the first couple of tier 1 towers and winning the first couple of fights as well. You see Newbee, the way they play with Tidehunter, once KP picks up level 6, you'll see him rotate to one of these lanes, maybe mid, maybe bottom, or maybe even the team will go to him, and they'll just bully down tier 1s, because who wants to fight a Ravage? No one, really.
But normally when they've got that, they've got like Chuan over online, he's able to get that first initiation, turning the fights in, like, from 5v5 into 4v5, and Newbee have that advantage too. Oh,
KP!
With the Scarabeels coming out, KP, there's extra help coming in from Misery, and maybe they can hold him in position. Yep, they will! Misery again, a second successful movement from him means that DC will not only have 2 hero kills, they're also going to inflict damage into that tier 1 tower on top.
Yeah, big mistake there from KP. He should have been able to make the read. Granted, the smoke did catch him off guard. He had an okay ward to see rotations, but he still should have been aware of the idea of a smoke rotation because the lane was pushing forward. It's very natural.
TP comes from KP. Already the Centaur from Misery moved in position. KP knows he can tank through this, especially when he has an IO behind him. So they're trying to push DC off this tower. They do not want to give up this lane control yet.
When you see a lane pushing forward, it oftentimes means that a support is going to wrap around and try and catch that offlaner from behind, because the last thing you want to do is push a lane into a tier 1 offlane and just give the offlaner free experience like that. So KP was just a bit far forward. He knows he can TP back in though, just because DC, once they've blown everything for that one kill, they're kind of out of steam at that point. Chen's going to have to reset back to the jungle, tries to steal away the rune away from Kaka, but he does manage to pick up the invis, punishes with a bit of damage, and that's all.
It was the same kind of battle on bottom lane with Chuan just glimpsing away, and he finds both the runes again.
Notice Moose early pickup of the TP scroll. This is in case, because they don't really have a heart disable, if he's forced to time walk away from a situation and gets glimpsed back, he can just straight up TP out.
Mm-hmm. All right, so again, we go back into this passive kind of timing. Maybe a little bit more difficult for DZ to keep this rotation happening as that Tidehunter is rapidly approaching level 6. Kind of another thing to also flag, like that window of opportunity for DC, the fact they do go in for KP before that Ravage is available. But because they didn't force down the tower, now KP's gonna feel very comfortable. And the CS board, it still leans the way of NewB with 43-22 over on that Lifestealer and 37-17 on the Viper. They're looking very good for their farm. Even KP, he's got 26 to his name. You do have to kind of take into account that DC is still running a jungler. They're still running the Chen. Mm-hmm. And it hasn't just been like with Misery's rotations, the fact he's got two kills as well, with the assistance from the Saturn, obviously the Centaur movement too. Like, he's had success on that front, but he still managed to pocket 27 CS out of the jungle.
Yeah, and he's going to have a relatively fast level 6. The ideal time would be having that level 6 when you first try and contest NewB's push, because I believe what's going to happen here is that the idea being that NewB, when they saw the Weaver drafted up, they had to get themselves a really strong laning phase, which is where they pick up heroes like the Viper. The Tidehunter, I think, was the best offlaner left at the time. It wasn't amazing, but it fits their lineup okay. Mm-hmm. NewB now have to go from an okay static laning phase to now trying to pressure tier 1s, and DC are going to be the ones deciding when to fight, when to actually contest that tier 1 tower push, and some of it will be based around the Chen's timing, his level 6, and when Weeha feels
top
comfortable
lane. They're going to go again here on KP. KP, he got actually touched up a little bit before. He's running back behind that tier 1 tower. The battle for the top room was happening at the same time.
The thing is, once you've got high levels of Kraken Shell, the swarm doesn't matter. It just, everything gets blocked away. So Tidehunter has a good amount of survivability now. As long as he didn't get crushed in level 1 or 2, he was naturally going to do okay.
I do like the build. Oh, hello middle lane with that Disruptor ulti. Weeha's locked in. The Exorcism is not going to do enough. And the TP support that was arriving from DC does not come in time, so now it's the mid of NewB will find themselves the first kill of NewB.
It looks like they didn't anticipate the Disruptor to be level 6 quite so fast. The Disruptor was able to get a lot of pulls out, a lot of extra experience gained from that dual lane. So that rotation a bit faster than Digital Chaos would have expected, and as such, they do leave Weeha to end up dying. NewB are a decent chunk of gold ahead now, about 2,000, so they're doing all right. The bigger thing is being able to transition from this to actually taking map control and limiting the farm at Digital Chaos, because DC are kind of greedy. That is the one downside of their lineup. They've got three cores that all need a decent amount of farm, so they may not be able to actually contest NewB if NewB starts snowballing too hard in the first 15 minutes.
Mm-hmm. But that snowball has to start sometime, and for now, it is still not that time just yet, as DC... It's like a little bit of a group up in the jungle, I thought for a moment. In fact, it actually is that. It's going to be a smoke movement coming out from DC. They include Weeha in this. The question is, can they find the opening? The middle lane move is a long, long way up. It was actually over on the Dire side of the river. But they don't find their opening there. It's the Dire Observer Ward on top lane, which is going to reveal their best position. And thanks to that Observer Ward, which is down from NewB, KP feels very, very secure. So they see him up the hill. He'll blow the Ravage straight away, catching them all out on the ramp. So KP will have to burn the Ravage, but he guarantees the smoke fails, and he stays alive, but he has to forfeit his tier 1 tower now.
Yeah, I love that play. It's a three-man smoke, including the mid of Digital Chaos moving out of his lane. I think that's well worth it to make sure that they actually don't get the Tidehunter kill and are just left with the tier 1 tower. Now it's going to be DC trying to pressure a tier 2. I don't think they can actually take it, but they can try and force as many heroes of NewB back to that tier 2. The question is whether or not they actually get caught by NewB.
Be careful. That line. Saska trying to move himself out. Howl's right on top of him with that open wounds. There's no way for the Lion to survive through this. No more support from DC to help him out. And they don't have the extra vision. They should also be careful about the deep ward which DC planted. They're going to have a very good vision around that ancient area, which is a heavy, heavy stack which they need to get into the back of KP.
You know NewB is a team that will full rotate as many heroes as possible to be able to win a fight. So when you go for a push like that, you have to make sure that you back out together. And that was just the positioning there by Soxa to try and run back through the secret shop for a little bit of, I guess, efficiency to be able to run through the river and perhaps back to mid. He gets caught there because he doesn't run straight back through the lane with the rest of his team. You got to be careful in mistakes like that, because Newbee, they see these openings constantly and they'll always punish you for it, especially with a hero like Disruptor. Positioning is key against this this Raptor hero.
Now, this game may feel like it's really, really close. If you look at the kill count, like, it's 2-2, we're 11 minutes in, everyone's getting what feels like a lot of decent farm across the map. But overall, you're still holding a 2k net worth advantage in for Newbee, and the experience is slowly and surely working up. When this ancient stat goes down, which is what KP is now beginning now, it's gonna be a hell of a lot of money coming in for the Tidehunter. And this is all gonna go in finishing that mech up nice and early on.
They've got a lot of defensive vision on the side of Newbee around this stack too. They want to make sure that it's cleared through, and you could see not only top of the vision, but also they're keeping four other heroes around it, just in case DC did go for a smoke rotation into that stack.
The Exism is about to wear off here for Weehaw. He's coming down to the tier 1 tower. I don't think Newbee's really going to mind if they have a very uncontested stack taken out here by the Tidehunter for a trade-off of a little bit of damage to their tier 1. And even then, they're actually pressuring into the tier 1 tower in mid lane. So there's a lot of trade-off just coming out, which is not in favor of Digital Chaos.
That's okay. If they get this tier 1 tower, I think Newbee is definitely being much more efficient. I think that's the nature of their lineup. But it is okay just because Misery had such a good game. They'll have their mech timings around the same point. And in that case, it makes it all right for Digital Chaos. They're giving up a lot of gold, but when it comes to the team fights, they'll be even on that sustain mark. Next thing, all they have to do is just go from pressuring that tier 1 to maybe trying to force Newbee down to tier 2 while also defending their mid tower, but I don't think Newbee's going to be too scared. I think prioritizing that mid tier 1 tower and start loosening the control of Roshan, of Digital Chaos, a little bit more is the best play at this point, because you want to make sure you get that into your hands if you're Newbee. An Aegis in the hands of Digital Chaos may actually slow down the game too much for Newbee.
Resolution's going to attempt the denial. Kind of read a little bit there by Chuan, feeling like someone was going to be around, so he put the wall down. Means Mu's able to get the last hit. Should also flag the fact that we're talking like a BKB Desolator build coming in for Resolution. He's actually moved in towards the Perseverance now, so it looks more like a Lincoln's build.
You know, I kind of felt like they needed to maximize their damage, because if they get a good Chronosphere, they need to make sure that Resolution can clear through one of those heroes that's caught in it. Now, whether it's going to be the Tidehunter, I think that's usually going to be the best option. They need to try and kill that big AoE controller as fast as possible, or maybe it ends up catching the Lifestealer, or maybe even the Viper. Either way, they have to maximize their damage to be able to kill that one hero in that short period of time before the hero has the opportunity to respond, because if you don't kill the within the Chronosphere timing, and he gets off the Ravage, the fight's immediately lost.
Visitor's gonna back out. KP revealing that Blink Dagger he went for. No mech this time around. He wants to get aggressive up against Misery. The mech will happen for Misery as he continues to retreat out. Hand of God is also up his sleeve if he wants to, and they move around the tree lines, but relocate. It comes in. The Ravage able to click on both of the DC heroes, but how much more can they get? The Hand of God will kick in. Thusk is finally gonna go down, and Misery will join him, so the Ravage committal does work for him. Resolution, well, he's gonna get locked in. The Static Storm, Resolution can't get himself away. Digital Chaos, they end up giving three hero kills over to Newbee. Resolution coming in for the consolation prize, but he ended up giving it to DC.
Yeah, that's the kind of mistakes that Digital Chaos cannot afford at this point in time. All they had to do was just give up on the Chen. There were too many heroes there. They should have just been able to give that one up, or even just the Lion. But Resolution going back into that fight, thinking he could challenge the Disruptor, whose AoE silence is incredibly strong against the Weaver, was a very clear mistake by him. And ultimately, he ends up feeding away such a big advantage now to Newbee. They are beginning that snowball now. It's 15 minutes in. They've got themselves over a 5,000 gold lead, and I don't anticipate the Heroes of Digital Chaos to be online fast enough. Resolution, even if he does finish up his Lincolns in the next 5 to 8 minutes, it won't be good enough. They won't have the damage. You're looking at Weehaw. He doesn't necessarily have a whole lot of tankiness either. He's going to be picking up the Veil eventually, but that by itself is not enough to prevent Newbee from bursting him down during the timing of that Ravage. So,
which means you have to rely on the control. Like, you look towards the hero who we haven't really felt any influence from at all, and that's Mu. You look towards the Faceless Void. If you can get a Chronosphere off, if you've got a second level Exorcism, if you can get the Beatles down, maybe then you've got a way where you can control up Newbee and can stop this big move all over you kind of fight that Newbee can work with, because they are just so tanky. Lifestealer and Viper always having an IO behind them. The Disruptor's getting good control, but you can maybe delete him as well. That line has Finger of Death. They just need a better opening, which means they need better vision. They need to know what's happening with NewB.
Yeah, you can see NewB how much they've expended in making sure that Digital Chaos do not have good wards up. You've got four different counter wards on the map just right now, and you look at it probably 5 minutes ago, and there's probably another two or three down. So NewB, it's working out for them simply because they are finding the kills and getting the tier one towers. Their supports are getting a reimbursement in all this gold that they're putting out.
I love this from NewB as well. Like, they understand that DC is not going to defend against them because the Observer Ward is sitting inside the DC jungle. They saw Weeha just farming up neutrals. He's just trying to find that level 11. In the meantime, NewB, just bold as brass, will walk in. They don't care about putting their heroes in the front line. They know they won't be initiated on. So they'll take two towers. The trade-off is a little bit of damage to the tier 2 tower up on top, but Chuan in position for that middle lane, gonna look for Mu. Mu jumps in, nice chronosphere, finding Chuan. KP gonna join him as well. Weeha lets the ulti rip with a follow-up silence. There won't be any ravage until for a second. Now is available. The disruptor, Chuan's already gone down. Weeha trying to get that space, goes into the tree line. Now the ravage will connect. Weeha into the tree lines. Can he stay alive? He's still being chased down by Hao, but nope, you can delete Weeha from this fight. There's still a chase going on mid lane with Misery being chased down by Mu. There's too much slow with the Viper Strike as well. Misery's got a mech charge, but doesn't even expend it. He accepts the fact that he's dead. And NewB, they are just so strong here. That pickoff did not come fast enough for DC.
Yeah, Digital Chaos are just executing the game plan just, I would say, 5 minutes too late. The fact that they tried to challenge NewB a little bit early on cost them quite a bit. And now the idea being that they try and split push on resolution the top lane and also challenge mid tier one whenever NewB show up on an opposite side of the map. That's the right play, and then you try and get pickoffs from there. But unfortunately, I think that NewB have managed to get too much out of the laning phase, and pickoffs are going to be extraordinarily hard to find for Digital Chaos. Another thing comes down to the lack of a Desolator. You don't really feel that pressure in the side lanes from a Weaver if he doesn't have that first big damage item. I understand why he feels like it's going to be necessary against the catch that NewB have in spades with the Disruptor, but ultimately, saving measures won't win you this game. You're going to have to play some aggressive game plan in order to get NewB off of their game where they just five-man and take towers and take control away from you.
The really sad thing, too, is like if you look back at that fight, like the Chronosphere wasn't bad. You got the perfect control over on the Tidehunter. Then there was the follow-up silence from the Death Prophet. You had all these things working for you. The only issue is you just didn't see inside the trees. So you couldn't inflict the damage from the Lion. That Finger of Death took a little too long to get out. And now Mu, okay, well, Chuan, they flood the vision. Then they glimpse him straight back into that ultimate. So Mu trucked in here with KP. They're going to relocate down towards this as well. So Mu will die. You do have all of NewB rotate over.
Yeah, but look what just happened, right? There were five heroes. Of course, they relocated to mid, but there were just five heroes in that mid lane, and they still lost their tier one tower at top. DC need to be able to exploit when NewB go for this five manning. Now, this is also why NewB go for the Wisp in their second pick, is because it really fits with their playstyle of wanting to be able to five man.
Oh, Misery. Goodbye.
Really early.
Really nice knowing you. That's an infest inside the Tidehunter. So Misery just gets very easily picked off. It was a big hero smoke movement. And thanks to the Observe Ward, which is already placed down, DC probably felt a little bit more comfortable inside the Radiant Jungle in that area, but still ends with NewB getting yet another what seems to be a very easy kill.
Digital Chaos plan being push out top lane, try and push mid hard, force rotations from NewB, but every single time one hero from NewB is enough to defend these pushes. Like Mu by himself, he just TP's right in front. He says, go ahead, if you try and show up with three heroes or more, I'll just be able to tank through it. My team will be able to respond. They'll get me. I still have a mech in my back pocket as well. You'll never be able to burst me down fast enough. And NewB will always be able to take those tier one tower defenses rather easily. So DC, I'm not exactly sure how they're going to be able to rotate around fast enough to keep NewB off kilter, because it seems like NewB have such an advantage with sometimes even a single sustain hero being able to stop a push.
This is one moment where maybe DC can make a play. Roshan gets begun by NewB. They put down an Observer Ward as well as a sentry. There's no way you can just slip yourself inside Invis, get inside the pip, and they're letting Hao and Mu do it. This will be a very, very slow Rosh for NewB. And this will allow time for DC to rotate over, but they're not coming. Weeha's still up on top lane. He's actually got almost no mana to speak of. Even if he TPs the tier 2 tower, there's no exorcism for the fight.
Go, so little skeleton warrior!
He's not making that pit.
He didn't make it into the Roshan pit. But they did at least get some reveal. They saw the Tidehunter throw out the Anchor Smash. So they do have an idea that Roshan is being done right now.
Asuka, they know the Chaunt's in the tree line. They're going to go for the Stun Finger of Death. They find the kill quickly. Roshan's already died, however. So you get the kill over on Chuan. But Aegis the Immortal gets picked up by the Lifestealer. So he's not just tanky, he is now immortal.
I mean, that's okay for DC simply because they got a pick. They're pushing out bottom, mid, and top lane at the same time. So they're getting a lot of map control out of this. And ultimately, I don't think you can contest NewBee. They're just too strong at team fighting right now. So if DC can try and leverage this map control that they have to stall up NewBee's five-man, that is the best possible thing for them. They're building up some of their mid-game items. They have right now the Blink Dagger on the Faceless Void. Looks like Mood's going to go back for the Vlads, which I think was smart. He needed that mobility item rather early on. The Lincolns is complete for resolution, so he'll feel a bit more comfortable aggressively split pushing down these lanes. The problem is he just doesn't have the damage yet to threaten the tier 2s.
But luckily for him, Desolator is cheap as chip, so it shouldn't take him that long to reach it. The only downside is NewBee is still pulling in so much money that Howe actually buys a Desolator of his own.
Yeah, exactly. He's got Armlet, SNY, Phase Boots, and Deso. He's ready to bully down tier 2s, and they can actually push high ground. Like, if you see a situation where NewBee are 5-manning into that tier 2, and you see Resolution pushing out bottom or top lane and trying to push a tier 2 of his own,
yeah.
NewBee at that point, once they take their tier 2 in mid, they'll just go, okay, we'll force you back by pushing high ground, because we can, because we've hit our biggest peak at around 25 minutes with Lifestealer and Viper in a game.
I know we were talking about this like when the draft was happening, but DC, if they want to push it to the late game, can they, like, if they can survive the NewBee horde, knowing just how far NewBee have already got their farm up on their cores, can they actually battle NewBee 5v5? Going into the later portion of the game, like, is there an advantage to delaying this one out? Do you reach a point where you're like, oh my, okay, well, this NewBee lineup is still going to kill us all?
There is absolutely going to be a point in time where Digital Chaos can win five-man fights, but it's going to be super late in the game at this point.
Glimpse back over, and now it's going to be Mu who goes down.
Because at this point in time, NewBee will always have a gold advantage, like a very significant one too. So even if this game draws out another 20 minutes, NewBee may still have the teamfight advantage simply because they'll be probably 10 to 15k gold up over DC. So Digital Chaos have a very long road ahead of them, and this is where we're really going to see whether or not this team has the kind of endurance to deal with a tough match like this.
Ashley test them out, Resolution running in between them, they get the Lincoln Sphere trigger. As he makes the tree line, they drop down the sentry wall so they could see Resolution inside of Ishikuchi. Just before that happened too, the push that came in through top lane, that's actually what forced Mu to rotate to the top.
What they need is, I think Soxa's positioning here is okay if he had maybe like one more core position. It looks like maybe the Void's going to rotate up. They need to try and pick off from behind one of these heroes that goes for the split push. So if they can actually kill Kaka here by Lion coming in from behind, burst him down with a Finger of Death, and then surround the Viper, who's tanky as all hell, but won't be able to have an escape mechanism, this could actually work out really well, but we'll see.
Thanks to the Observe for what they had, they know that you actually have Kaka behind, and there it is. Yep, they jump in. They find Kaka. Chen's gone down in the meantime to Misery, so maybe this isn't the best trade-off. They need to find that core. They need Mu to die on bottom lane at the same time. The tier 2 tower's being pressured, and they're having to chase a long, long way to find Mu. Weehan will finally send him up with that Yule Scepter, and with the extra support coming in from Lion, it will be two heroes gone, but bottom lane, you still have issues. It's Hal beating into that bottom tower, doing terrible, terrible damage, bringing it down by 50% already, and nothing's really going to stop him. What's Resolution gonna do?
He still
needs that second Mithril Hammer.
Yeah, it's the small things, right? They probably figured that Faceless Void, he may have TP top. If not, they'll see the TP coming. Either way, the glyph was just used. NewBee, no, that's a time to punish. Even if we don't complete taking the tier 3 tower, we're going to maximize our trade-offs. Even though DC just made a good play at the top lane, I would say that trade is pretty good for them, simply because they have to make aggressive pickoffs like that if they hope to be able to come back in this game.
And they have to try something. But for now, it still feels like NewBee have quite firmly the reins of this game.
they have to go for a fight. I think Digital Chaos still needs to, they still have their Chronosphere. They need to go for a pickoff in the mid lane now while the Viper is still gone for 5 seconds. But unfortunately, they're being a bit hesitant about it. You can see why.
They just don't see anything on the map.
Yeah.
You actually need to have basically a gem coming up on DC to get rid of the aggressive warding of NewB. So they're not always being watched by NewB, and at the same time, they can move out, they can maybe gank up and track down anything.
Now it's a bit too late, and NewB will be able to get their 5-man right outside the tier 3 range.
Oh, how? Just keep beating into it. He doesn't care as long as he's got the Aegis. The Immortal bottom lane, they find Lion. So say goodbye to your burst damage. Moo jumps out. He finds KP, but
they're
that damage is so minimal.
Enough.
They'll force off him away. So KP will survive. Weeha, you'll set this up defensively. The Finger of Death will not take off KP. He'll let the Ravage go, catching up 3 of DC. Still walking away. KP will survive. The Dire Creep Wave's giving him the vision. Death Prophet is down. You bought back on your Lion, trying to find that extra burst damage quickly. But it's just NewB. They reset out. KP's not a healthy man, but you don't care. You got Howl on the front lines.
Yeah, you could see NewB are just simply too far ahead. The fact that they went for that Chronosphere and weren't even close to killing KP fast enough to prevent the Ravage from going off. That's the only way they win that team fight right there, especially with the pickoff that just happened on the Lions. So now, one lane of racks down, NewB not going to slow down at all. Why should they? They still have this big tanky lifesteal in the front lines.
They just don't have
Viper
the Aegis anymore. Like that's the only thing which would be in the back of the minds, just saying, okay, we don't have that easy immortality from Hal, so he is susceptible to the gank. You're going to have Moo jump forward as KP just blocks a lot of the damage in a quick anchor smash blink forward. Also takes a lot of the aggro of DC. They finally freed DC. That wall from Chuan was holding him back, and now as Moo's in trouble. Time walk 1 second. He's got one charge to get him there, and then leap away to safety. Another silence, just trying to keep the control going. The NewB, they got a lot of survivability. Now with the 4-star back out again, they might be running a little bit low on charges.
DC are in this really weird position where they know they need to actually force the fight, otherwise they're just simply too far behind, but they also can't take the full 5-man, so they're kind of pursuing after NewB, hoping they can get that pickoff or something, but it's just not going to happen, not without the Chronosphere, so.
And NewB seems to always just be giving them one hero, which is enticing. It's like they're almost, yes, this will be enough. KP jumps in underneath your tier 3 towers. Yes, you can find him. Now you got to chase him, and let's keep pulling and kiting away. And then, oh, that really, it's a refresher.
Yeah.
Oh boy, that's
he's very farmed.
Yeah, I don't really know how DC meant to deal with two Ravages, let alone one. And that's also an Assault Cuirass build-up too. That's...
KP is tanky as hell too. Even without the refreshers, he's still really impactful because of Anchor Smash. He jumped in that last team fight, he jumped on top of both the Weaver and the Faceless Void, got an Anchor Smash off, and boom, there goes half your damage of the team. Like, they have no real sustained damage at this point, simply because they're lacking the items.
Oh, for now, DC, at least they put one foot onto the other side of the river, aka the Lion. Misery's gonna come with them. They're hoping for just one quick, like, some kind of, like, relieving, like, pressure-relieving pick. That's all they need. The problem is the only hero that's showing themselves in the top lane currently is Hal, and they do not have the damage to kill him off.
Yeah, they would need, like, three or four heroes of Digital Chaos just to be able to have a chance at killing Hal. They're gonna run into him now, but he gets off the rage too quickly.
Yep.
Fed to the Lions.
That's almost impossible, with an IO always sitting behind him too. It's wishful thinking, and that's a Lion. At least he gets to expend that long death timer, which he had after his buyback.
All right,
that's
well,
the upside.
NewB are like, okay, look at the clock. It's about time to end the game. If they wanted to, they could really sit back and wait for Roshan.
Okay, now he's gonna jump himself away, glimpse back over, and that's what Chuan was waiting for. Falling back into the Static Storm instead of just starting with the Static Storm. So there's no Faceless Void for 50 seconds. There is no buyback. And without a Chronosphere, DC just do not have the AoE control.
Yeah, they really don't. Without that pickoff, NewB might have waited for an Aegis just because they know they've got a lot of time on their hands, but a pickoff on the Faceless Void makes it so it's not possible for them to be able to win a team fight. So
they can't just rotate up and go for Megas thanks to the tier 2 tower still being alive for DC. You have Resolution on that bot lane who's now reaching the tier 3 tower. He brought down the tier 2 at least, but how? Okay, they're going to TP back, they're going to defend. NewB are going to be so systematic with this. Just move up towards the top lane, push it, win it.
This is the safest course of action, right? If you went for this some sort of crazy push tier 4s and try and threaten drone play. Who knows? Maybe the Faceless Void does have buyback. Maybe just because of the proximity of the fountain, you can't actually win the fight, and you start throwing away some gold back to the way of Digital Chaos. No reason to give them those kind of openings. Just defend your bottom lane, start pushing it out. Once it's around to close to the river point in time, NewB can just go for another five-man top.
It's also really important for NewB hitting the playoff part. We saw a couple of issues coming out. The roster over at Epicenter, the group stage was like pretty good. The qualifications, all the matches leading up to it, everyone was talking about the huge win streak they had, and then just a couple of things went wrong. So by showing this patience, you know that NewB is like, you know, we don't have to make mistakes, we won't make mistakes, and we'll still be able to take this game of Dota. Might wait a little bit longer, it won't be as flashy, but it's definitely going to be the same result they want. Straight victory.
Yeah, one of the losses they had was against OG, right? And that was the first time that we saw a way a team's aggressiveness could try and exploit NewB's timings that they usually look at. They're not necessarily a team that needs to win the laning phase. They'll shore up with rather static laning phase, oftentimes grouping up, having very early full TP rotations from the full team to be able to defend over aggression, and they'll wait till they hit their timings around 15 minutes. This is a lineup that definitely does get strong at 15 and only gets stronger at 25. And you see NewB are now prolonging that timer by being able to get some incredibly early late game items like the hearts coming soon on the lifestealer. Moose got a Scotty. Even if this game does stretch on another half hour, it's hard to see how Digital Chaos would ever be able to get the farm to contest these heroes.
Yeah. It seems like an impossible task, and NewB, they're actually not doing just that straight push. It's like they just want to take a good fight. They'll take Roshan next time when he's up, which is back to now. So they'll just slip inside the pit, and DC, like, it's like their only chance is to come down here and hope for just a like one hell of a chronosphere. But NewB understand this, and that's why they're waiting. They move up, they break the smoke,
nice,
and there's a shot. KP hits the entire team. Say goodbye to Resolution,
GG,
and say goodbye to DC. That game is over. KP just basically sealed that one so perfect. They saw them coming from a mile away, and DC will be wiped by NewB here in game one of this best of three. That wasn't anywhere near close.
No, absolutely not. NewB, very dominant win here in game number one. I mean, the analysts all agreed, and I was with them. I thought Digital Chaos had a pretty good plan here for game number one. I thought their draft was decent, but NewB completely outplayed them. I think Digital Chaos were a little bit iffy on their timings and what exactly the strategy of this lineup was supposed to be able to employ, and NewB very much understood like how to exploit this timing. They knew the heroes on